So welcome everyone to this final instalment of this year's Ian Ramsey Centre Humane Philosophy Project seminar series on the topic of naturalism. I'm Ralph Weir. I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the Humane Philosophy Project, and I'd like to express for one final time our great gratitude to the Ian Ramsey Centre for Science and Religion, to Blackfriars Hall, Oxford, and to the Institute of Philosophy at the University of Warsaw for supporting this series and making it possible. Our speaker for this evening is Howard Robinson. Howard is a University of Professor in Philosophy at the Central European University, Hungary. He was a full-time stipendiary lecturer here in Oxford at Oriel College from 1970 to 1974. After that, he took up a lectureship at the University of Liverpool, where he remained for 26 years, becoming a first senior lecturer and then reader, apart from a short period as Soros Professor of Philosophy, again in Hungary. In 2000, he was appointed Professor of Philosophy at the Central European University, and between 2007 and 2010, he was Provost and Academic Pro-Rector of the University. Howard specializes in the philosophy of mind and metaphysics, including the philosophy of religion. I should say, as a personal aside, I first got to know Howard when I wrote to him, being a great admirer of his work and thinking he was someone I'd like to work with at some point. And I had the pleasant surprise, thinking I was writing to someone in Hungary, of finding out that half of the year he spends in Oxford and turned out to live just 5 minutes away from me. And so that led to many very pleasant discussions from which I've benefited greatly, of course. His seminal 1985 book, Matter and Sense. 82? Wikipedia must be wrong. his seminal 1982 book, Matter and Sense, is a forceful critique of the forms modern materialism has taken, and it continues to be influential throughout Europe and America. And his most recent publication, From the Knowledge Argument to Mental Substance, was just published this year by Cambridge University Press. Today, Howard's going to speak to us on the topic why there is no such thing as naturalism, and I bid you to give him a very warm welcome.
Thank you very much, Ralph, and thank you to everyone for the invitation. Why there is no such thing as naturalism? This is rather a dramatic kind of claim, and I'm obviously shooting a line, but I hope it makes some kind of sense and is at least an interesting, provocative theme. To begin with, what is naturalism? The term is certainly vague and even flexible. Some would equate it with physicalism, also hard enough to define. Others say that they are naturalists but not physicalists. John McDowell, for example, and Tim Crane, soon to be my colleague in Budapest, now abandoning the fens of Cambridge, is also one, I think. So I feel free to be at least a little stipulative in defining what it is. But I hope and believe that the way I define our topic is intuitive and mainstream enough for it not to seem that I'm attacking a straw man. Naturalism, I say, affirms the following proposition, and this is on your handout. The natural world, one, the natural world that we see around us, taken historically in its past and future, is an entity sufficient unto itself. In particular, it does not require any other realm or entity either to explain how it came into existence or as a precondition of its existence. This definition takes for granted that we know what we mean by the natural world. It is what natural science investigates, but not necessarily in a sense that insists that science tells us everything that there is to know about it. That is where the term is looser than physicalism and allows, for example, for McDowell's second nature, if there is such. It can also allow for forms of mind-body dualism, provided that they hold that the mind is generated by the body and depends on it for its existence, For example, Tim Crane, who is, I think, an interactionist property dualist, would count by this criterion as a naturalist, and he would want to count himself as a naturalist. But it clearly rules out natural theology, philosophical arguments for the existence of God from facts about the natural world. But I want to add a further condition, namely, two, the claim that the natural world does not require any other realm or entity to ground it applies not only to the world itself, but to the world as it can be known by us. The point of this second condition is to rule out Kantianism as a form of naturalism. That is, somebody might claim that the world in itself, the noumenal world in Kantian terms, is self-sufficient, but the world as we know it essentially depends on our mentality, on the categories of our mind. Although somebody might contest this, I'm going to assume that transcendental idealism of this sort is not a form of naturalism. The relevance of this to the argument, as I develop it, will become clear, I hope. I shall try to point it out. So what I'm going to do, or try to do, is to deny the self-sufficiency of the natural world as we know it. I will argue this by claiming that our conception of the natural world, A, this is on the handout too, depends on the nature of our experience. Another way of putting this is to say that there is no autonomous, adequate notion of the world as conceived according to scientific realism that does not depend on a more traditional empiricism, which takes human experience as a primitive. That is, as something the basic qualitative nature of which cannot be thought of as being part of the physical world. And B, that it also depends in a substantive way on the existence of a Platonic realm that is not in itself naturalistic. C, this latter, the naturalistic, the Platonic world, ties in with the former, the world of experience and mind, because the Platonic realm is essentially noetic. It is, as the Neoplatonists believed, a mind, not a set of objects. And so our natural world depends on the realm of experience and thought, the latter at least not being only human thought. This is a big program, and so at some points I shall only sketch out the arguments provocatively, pointing to places, in some cases, where I've argued in more detail. But I hope that some of what I have to say will be tight enough to stand on its own right, and the rest interesting enough as to provoke further thought. I shall begin by saying why empiricism holds pride of place over scientific realism, and why this goes against naturalism, as I've characterized it. The next section could be entitled The Real Power of the Knowledge Argument. Can I assume that people know what the knowledge argument is? You know, Mary in her room and all that? Or should I say something about it?
A brief.
Okay. This argument became famous because of an article of Frank Jackson's in the early 80s. I used it a bit in Matter and Sense too, in a slightly different form. Jackson imagines a woman called Mary who lives in a room without any chromatic colours. She never experiences chromatic colour, but she knows all the science about the perceiving of chromatic colour, both about the nature of light waves, the nature of the objects that reflect them, and about the nature of brain states that enable one to perceive chromatic colour. But she's never had the experience. In Matter and Sense, I use a slightly different example, somebody born deaf, but who knows all about the neurology and science of hearing. The thought is that such a creature, if they could start to have the experiences they were missing, would learn something new. So knowing all the physical facts in physicalist terms, in scientific terms, doesn't tell you everything, because if you began to have the experience, you'd learn something new. So that's an argument against the completeness of physicalistic type knowledge. It can be argued that standard forms of physicalism cannot make a plausible answer to this argument, known as the knowledge argument. Knowledge argument because you learn something new, the deaf scientist in my case, or Mary in Jackson's case, when they start to have experiences that they'd not had before, even though they knew all the science. And I've argued in the recent book that Ralph mentioned that the physicalists can't cope with this, and many other people have argued the same. But I think that the usual protagonists of the argument do not appreciate its full or comprehensive force. The dialectical situation in which the knowledge argument for property dualism is usually taken to be located is the following. It is taken as agreed that physicalism gives an adequate account of non-conscious reality, physical science, and that this part of reality constitutes almost 100% of the universe. But despite this overwhelming success, however, the physicalist account struggles to accommodate certain features of mental life, namely the what it is like, or qualia, of certain conscious states, what it is like to see colour in the Mary case and what it is like to hear in my deaf scientist case. These qualia constitute the qualitative nature of sensations and probably of secondary qualities, but have nothing to do with our robust conception of the physical as it applies to the mindless, vast mindless tracts of reality. These awkward entities, the qualia, the qualitative nature of experience, constitute what David Chalmers calls the hard problem for physicalism. But the fact that they also constitute such a tiny part of the world is implicitly understood as being a strong prima facie reason for thinking that there must be some way of reconciling their apparent existence with the otherwise triumphant and clearly adequate physicalist account of the world. If it were not for the qualia that occur in a few corners of reality, the brains of conscious beings, the adequacy of physicalism would not be in any way in dispute. Now, I think that this interpretation of the situation constitutes a radical misunderstanding and understatement of the problem that faces physicalism and the problem that the knowledge argument plays in bringing out that problem. And the role, sorry, that the knowledge argument plays in bringing out that problem. The dialectic is quite different from the way it is represented as I have just put it. To see why and how this is so, one must direct attention at our conception of matter and the physical, rather than at our concept of mind. Science, whether of the macroscopic or the microscopic, is very largely concerned with measurement and quantification, and with the expression of its findings in mathematics, as far as possible. But the resultant abstract conception of the physical cannot, we think, wholly capture our concept of the physical, especially as it is conceived in our naive or common sense conception of the world. Taken in this abstract form, the concept of the physical is insufficiently concrete. But what concretizes it is the addition of qualities, essentially sensible qualities, that figure so importantly in our naive and commonsensical or manifest image. Our manifest image, as Sellers put it, conception of the world. These are essential to our ability to cache or model or interpret the abstract mathematical conception that science gives us. Physicalism's real predicament, as has been brought out in my view by the knowledge argument, can be represented in two propositions, again on the handout. One, standard physicalism cannot capture the qualitative nature or aspect of reality. And two, the qualitative is an essential feature of any conception of the physical that goes beyond the purely abstract and mathematically expressed. These two together entail standard physicalism cannot capture any conception of the physical that goes beyond the purely abstract or mathematically expressed. This is, of course, a much stronger conclusion than that which the normal understanding of the hard problem attributes to the knowledge argument, namely, four, standard physicalism cannot capture the qualitative nature of certain mental states. It can't capture the qualitative nature of anything, including the nature of the physical world. On my reinterpretation of the situation, what the knowledge argument really shows is the first premise there, standard physicalism cannot capture the qualitative nature or aspect of reality. I take, too, that the qualitative is an essential feature of our conception of the physical to be independently plausible, possibly analytically true, and probably largely uncontested. One and two together show that standard physicalism is not merely incomplete, failing to cope with consciousness, but something more like incoherent, because it cannot give a coherent account of the physical itself. In what follows, I shall try to show that the knowledge argument, if sound, proves that physicalism cannot capture the qualitative at all. I'll try and prove what I've just asserted, in other words. The knowledge argument, the argument about Mary, as traditionally stated, appears to concern only the nature of mental states, as found in our experience of secondary qualities. Mary has never experienced chromatic colour. My deaf scientist has never heard a sound. Secondary qualities. This appearance is founded on two factors. First, the argument concerns what it is like to have certain experiences, and this expression, what it is like, clearly names something subjective. This alone is not enough to confine the topic to the mental world. If one is talking about what it is like to feel pain or jealousy, then this might be seen to be purely internal. But what it is like to see colour or to hear sound is directly connected with our notion of what colour is like or what sound is like, as those things are, or as we naively conceive them to be, in the external world. There's an irony here. It is a feature of the accounts many physicalists present of experience that it is transparent. This means that the only feature that characterizes the experience, qua experience, is the apparent presence of some objective or external property. So what it is like to experience red or C sharp is no different from what red is like or what C sharp is like. This transparency alone is not enough, however, to show that the knowledge argument concerns our conception of the external or physical world. Because the qualities that are invoked in the argument are secondary qualities. And at least since John Locke, it's standard within the scientific form of physical realism to treat secondary qualities, insofar as they are not just powers or dispositions, but are real monadic qualities, as subjective. This leaves, a traditional Lockean might think, the physical world untouched, for that is characterized wholly by primary qualities, such as shape, movement, mass, etc. Once one has reached this point, it ought to be becoming clear why the argument does not concern secondary qualities alone. It's true that whilst red is defined in terms of what it is like to perceive it, square is not. But someone's conception of square is not independent of what it is like for them to perceive, see, touch, or whatever the senses there might be, square things. For if it were, it would be wholly axiomatic and mathematical. Using Sellers's convenient terminology, I can't stand Wilfrid Sellers as a philosopher, but this particular piece of terminology is very useful. Our manifest image of the world is a projection of what it is like to perceive it in respect of both primary and secondary qualities. The secondary qualities are attached to a particular form of experience, the primary are not. But without any experience, in our case, visual or tactile or both, there would be no conception of the spatial properties beyond the wholly mathematical. What the knowledge argument really brings out is that only experience of the appropriate kind can reveal the qualitative as opposed to purely formal and structural features of the world. What the standard modern physicalist fails to notice is that the kind of things that Frank Jackson's Mary didn't know, generalized from color vision to all the other sensible qualities, is essential to any contentful conception of the world, and hence that physicalism without it would lack any empirical content. be a formal system again. The generalization of the knowledge argument can be expressed as follows. This is on the handout. Take any property P, which is a quality or has a qualitative aspect, then it will be true of any subject S who has no experiential grasp on that qualitative aspect, but otherwise has full knowledge of all matters relating to P, that S lacks knowledge of P's qualitative aspect. I call this the generalization of the argument, but one might with equal justice say that it's the principle underlying the argument. The thought experiment merely makes its truth clear. It's vital to appreciate that this rationale applies to primary qualities as much as to secondary. The fact that it's easier to describe a thought experiment in which somebody has experience like ours except the chromatic colours are missing than it is to imagine experience like ours without spatial features, if that's possible at all, does not affect the fact that an empirically contentful conception of space depends on visual or tactile or some other experience of a spatial field to give us a conception of what space might be empirically like, and that this is dependent on what it is like to perceive it in some particular way. Am I speaking at the right volume and the right speed and all those kind of things?
Oh, very good.
All right, good. Well, that's a further claim. Imagine a mind with auditory experience and which lacks any other senses that might be sufficient to contribute a sense of space. So it's a disembodied listening mind. The sounds it hears are simply those, say, of verbal discourse. If such a mind could be taught verbally all the proofs of geometry and of relativity theory, it seems clear that its resultant grasp on the nature of empirical space would be no better than Mary's on colour. The mind would have a purely scientific or formal conception in a way that did not guarantee he would have any conception of what space was or might be like in itself or qualitatively. I want to emphasise that any worries one might have about whether there could be such a mind as this are not to the point. The prima facie intelligibility of the suggestion is enough to bring out the point that our conception of primary qualities as more than purely formal is not independent of what it is like to experience them. So though the knowledge argument is most easily stated in terms of secondary qualities, which are seemingly easily relegated to the dustbin of the mind, the principle of the argument can be carried through for primary qualities that are fundamental to our conception of the physical world. Our conception of these is, at bottom, no more independent of what it is like to perceive them than our conception is of secondary qualities. I say at bottom because primary qualities are not dependent on any particular form of experience, but this doesn't mean that we can have an interpreted or modelled conception of them without some form of qualitative content derived from experience. Furthermore, the doctrine of the transparency of perception applies as much to primary as to secondary qualities. So what it is like to see square is only the obverse of what squareness is visually like. And in fact, our own experience bears this out. I've just suggested that a mind with no spatial experience could not gain a better than abstract conception of space on the basis of learning geometry or relativity theory and the like. But this is not so far from our own situation. Insofar as our own grasp on four and above spatial dimensions, many dimensional spaces, or on relativistic or bent space is not purely mathematical, it depends on trying imaginatively to extend the two and three dimensions of which we have had actual experience. This attempt is only limitedly successful. We do not really achieve a grasp on what four or more dimensions or other spatial exotica that go beyond experience could actually be like. The narrative of Flatland makes plausible the thought that creatures that lived in two dimensions would have a similar difficulty to the one we have with more than three dimensions in giving imaginative content to three dimensions. None of these cases is the problem of a lack of theoretical knowledge. It's a lack of the kind of experience that could give interpretation to that knowledge. The correct way of looking at the rationale of the knowledge argument is to see it as granting content to the physicalist hypothesis only for purposes of argument. Even if we grant, it says, that physicalism could cope with the rest of reality, it cannot cope with what it is like to experience things. But once one recognizes the connection between what it is like to experience the world and what we can conceive the world we experience to be like, one can see that if physicalism cannot capture the former, it cannot capture the latter. One cannot have an adequate conception of the physical which does not include those qualitative components that are the transparent projections of the qualitative nature of experience. Seen in this way, it begins to look as if the knowledge argument can't fail to be right. For if there were not some special kind of content that is revealed only in experience, then we could not have any empirically significant conception of the world in the first place. So if you're tempted to think that physicalism might somehow be able to diffuse the intuition that Mary learns something substantive and new, you need only, when she gets out of her room and sees colours for the first time, you need only direct your attention to the way that any non-formal conception of the physical is dependent on the qualitative nature of reality as revealed uniquely in experience to see that this could not possibly be true. So no one, I think, would wish to deny the following. Bottom of page one on your handout. Our naive, commonsensical or manifest image of the physical world essentially has qualitative features. That is, in addition to formal and mathematical features, it has qualitative features that cannot be reduced to the formal ones. And for what I've already argued, it's clear that these qualitative features derive via the transparency of perception from the nature of qualia. And as qualia contribute an essential component to the commonsensical conception of the physical, it would seem that, three, the nature of qualia cannot be analysed as some function of or on the operations of the physical, naively conceived. The way the argument undermines standard physicalism can be put even more comprehensively. A standard statement of physicalism is that it is the theory according to which phenomenal or other mental states supervene with metaphysical necessity on physical states. Supervenience is an asymmetric dependence relation. It presupposes that the nature of the supervenience base does not essentially depend on that which supervenes on it. One can at least conceive of the base in the absence of the supervenient properties. But the knowledge argument shows that the physical cannot be conceived autonomously of elements dependent on the mental, namely on the qualitative nature of experience. Perhaps we don't want the next bit, let me see. Perhaps we do. It's more or less explicit for the physicalist that, little one, we can have a grasp on the nature of the physical in scientific terms. What I suspect most physicalists accept, but which is not discussed in this context, is, two, our concept of the physical is not purely mathematical and formal, but involves a qualitative component. And once one recognizes, two, and one considers both or either of the knowledge argument as I have re-expressed it, and the apparent transparency of at least some features of our experience, where what it is like is mere another side of what the thing out there is like, it's difficult to deny, three, we can only have a clear grasp on a quality, be able to imagine what it's like, if it's ultimately based on qualia. That's to say, on the qualitative nature of experience. A quality is a transparent projection of some aspect of the what it is like of experience, a quali. From this it follows our conception of the physical is conceptually dependent on the nature of qualia. And from this it follows qualia or qualia possessing states cannot be analysed or explicated in terms of some function of or operation on the physical, as independently conceived. But does this not leave the option of a naturalistic dualism? No. This is where ruling out Kantian idealism as a form of naturalism comes in. The knowledge argument, if I'm right, doesn't merely show that our mental states are irreducible, but that our conception of the natural world relies essentially on the nature of those irreducible states. But does it reveal their actual nature, at least with respect to the primary qualities? May it not be that the physical world out there really does just consist of these primary qualities as we experience them? So we do get a qualitative understanding of the world through experience. The world itself is not dependent on our experiences. Our experiences merely reflect it. It's a mirror, at least in the primary qualities sense. Is physical space qualitatively the way it looks or feels? And physical squareness qualitatively the way we experience it? It seems to me that, at best, there is no reason to think so. From Molyneux's problem to Bertrand Russell's argument that, for neither space nor time, does the physical qualitatively match the phenomenal, there seem to me to be strong reasons to deny resemblance. Berkeley's claim that nothing can be like an idea but an idea, Berkeley claims that, and this seems to be question begging, but the fact that the qualitative reveals itself only in experience should make one ponder. I remember the senior Strawson, Sir Peter Strawson, claiming at one point that it just was a category mistake to think that the world out there could be like the way it appears. That, I suppose, showed he's strongly Kantian. And therefore, whether he liked it or not, semi-idealist inclinations. It seems true to say that only in visual experience do the phenomena not seem to be essentially connected to effect. That's another fact that Berkeley makes a lot of. Think of most of your experiences. One of the unusual things about colour experiences is there's no real particular effect. You know, red or green, you like it or you don't care. Almost every other experience is inseparable from, as Aristotle put it, the pleasant or the unpleasant, or something of that sort. And so it looks as if the qualitative nature of things, as revealed in experience, is essentially tied up with experience. You couldn't have something like that, perhaps, unless it was a form of experience. The relative lack of affect in vision seems to suggest the opposite, but every other sort of experience suggests that that is true. Qualitativeness is essentially a form of experience. So this brings us to my point about empiricism and physicalism. The case I've been presenting can be put in a more formal manner, as follows. One, qualities based on what it is like of experience are essential to our common sense or manifest image world, and our conception of the features in it. Two, our scientific conception of the world is either purely mathematical or formal, or insofar as it is not just this, is modelled on the basis of the manifest image itself. Three, purely mathematical or formal concepts cannot provide a complete account, analysis or reduction of the what it is like of experience. Therefore, the non-formal mathematical modelled component is essentially dependent on the what it is like of experience to give a complete account. The non-formal mathematical element in the physical world, if there is one, it depends upon the nature of experience. Therefore, we know that the what it is like does not resemble qualitatively anything in physical space in the case of secondary qualities. And there are good reasons for thinking that this is true in the case of primary qualities too. Therefore, any non-abstract or non-mathematical, whatever, non-purely mathematical, account of the natural world depends essentially on the nature of sense experience in ways we have reason to believe the world itself does not mirror. So that's my first point. It is, as it were, the primacy of empiricism over scientific realism. It's interesting the way that in the late 19th century and then in 20th century philosophy, There's a tradition which is empiricist, which insists that you can't get anywhere without taking the nature of human experience as primitive. Even the early positivists were like that, and certainly Russell and Frédéric, in his review of Armstrong's materialist theory of mind, said this is okay provided you pretend we're anaesthetized. You cannot eliminate the experiential as the foundation of everything else. But scientific realism starts off from the thought, okay, science tells us about that non-mindless world, and it tells us about it in a way which is adequate for the grasp of what it is, and see if we can use this to accommodate experience. And it just doesn't make any sense. There's no real content beyond the sums, as it were, to the conception of the world without the primacy, not just the epistemological primacy, not just beginning to get to know things, but the conceptual primacy of the empirical. How much longer do you think I've got?
It's a little flexible, but perhaps between 15 minutes and half an hour.
Right. That should be. It shouldn't take any longer than that, certainly. So what about the presupposition of Platonism? This part of my talk will be even more programmatic than what has gone so far. Not, that's to say, I'm going to say a lot of things which I haven't got the time here to defend, though some of which I've defended in other places. I believe that some form of Platonism about universals is true. My reasons for thinking this are as follows. The options are, one, the standard forms of nominalism, two, resemblance nominalism, three, tropism, four, in re realism, and five, Platonism of some kind. Now, I think that David Armstrong's arguments in his two-volume work on universals from about 1980 against standard forms of nominalism and the resemblance theory are correct. Tropism seems to me to be incoherent. And this is not an argument much used, but it seems to me to be. I don't know whether it's used at all, but from by me, which makes me wonder whether it may be just missing the point. But nevertheless, tropism seems to be incoherent because it treats instance of F as more primitive than F, which doesn't seem to make any sense. So tropism is the view that you red things, there's no universal redness, there are just individual red tropes, or square tropes, or whatever. And that you can have that without having the universal. But that just seems to me to treat the, if you like, hyphenated instances of F as if it's more primitive than F, and that just doesn't make sense. Armstrong's in re realism about universals, where he says there are universals, but they're only in their instances, they don't exist in the Platonic anti-Rem sense, won't do because it forces one to a combinatorial theory of possibility, which Armstrong defends and against which I've written. And this is too restrictive. One could follow David Lewis and adopt his radical realism about possible worlds, where every possible world is physically real in different spatio-temporal setups, every logically possible world. But like most philosophers, I think this theory is just too bizarre. This leaves only Platonism, the idea that universals exist, forms exist in Platonic terms, independently of their instances. Now, of course, all the above is very contentious, and I've just sketched the positions and why I'd reject, or my authorities for rejecting some of them, saying that Armstrong has already refuted them, but I'm taking it as given. Obviously, if I try to defend all those positions, we'd be here until sometime in the middle of next week. And the drink would have run out by then. Why should this worry a naturalist? Why should a naturalist be worried about Platonism? Quine, who very much was a naturalist, thought that abstract objects, particularly in his case sets and mathematical entities, were acceptable if they were necessary for the best scientific theory of the world. And he thought they were necessary, sets at least. My conclusion will show a brief reflection on that, I think. My final last remark will be a quotation from Quine, more or less. Why are anti-Rame objects, abstract objects, worrying for the naturalist? Why should the naturalist worry about having to allow a platonic world? First, they seem to be a precondition for the natural world, if you believe in them at all. There can or could be square things only if squareness exists. And they seem to be eternal. Once one disavows the only in re theory and says they are necessary for possibilities, they must be timeless. Second, there is their relation to the mind. Banasaroff raised the problem of how, within a naturalistic framework, we can be in contact with abstract objects. But surely they are the raw material, so to speak, of thought. You think about using concepts which are universals, which are the, as it were, the mental side of the abstract objects, which are the Platonic world. Plato believed in the immortality of the soul because of its natural affinity with the forms. And if forms are immaterial and eternal, and if the mind is something that apprehends them, then this is a tempting thought. The mind must be, as it were, eternal as well, or immortal. But as Plato realized, this realm of forms faces many problems. Platonism faces many problems. I think it would be fair to say that these problems have their source in his attempt to treat universals as a strange kind of particular thing, treating concepts as objects, one might say. Plato reaches his position in the following way. Now, you've got the summary of Ian Crombie's view there. I don't think I'll quote that. A reconstruction of Plato's original position, in my view, could be put as follows. One, there are kinds, call them forms, as well as particulars. You could call them universals as well. Plato calls them forms. Because these forms exist, they must have a nature. There must be an account of what they are in themselves. The only account to hand is that they are the property they represent, pure and unadulterated. This explains how something's participating in them can give the things the appropriate quality. If you dip something in red paint, it comes out red. If it participates in the form of redness, it comes out red. Therefore, forms are what gets called self-predicating. They exemplify the property that they are the form of. Now, everybody's thought that Plato's doctrine of self-predication is absurd. Redness is not red. And I used to think it was absurd. I've become worried about this since. The concept red is not red, but that which is to be found in many places is the vivid colour itself. So if the universal is the thing that is to be found in many places, it looks as if it ought to be, forget about the word predicating, self-exemplifying in some way or other. It's not that something colourless makes things coloured by participating in them. But I don't want to pursue that line, but I do think that the Neoplatonists, well, I'll say something about this later on, that get themselves into difficulty. Well, no, they face a difficulty that there really is about that. Now, Aristotle rejected this theory, the self-predicating nature of forms and forms as a kind of individual, on the grounds that it makes forms into a kind of particular. Aristotle's particular solution, explicit solution, was what I say under Aristotle Part 1. You do not want entities that are hybrid between universals and particulars, and this is what Platonic forms are. Two, you avoid this by having individualized forms as particulars in things and universals as acti mentis, acts of mind. Now, this looks like a kind of conceptualism, where concepts only exist in minds out there that are just particulars, tropes, if you like. But it's not, as we can see if we follow the story. Frege had a similar problem with Platonic theory to Aristotle, though he was a Platonist. He too thought that one had to avoid treating universals as objects. Concepts are not objects. His account runs as follows, Frege's position. There are transcendent universals called concepts, but they are incomplete entities. Objects are complete in their own right. Concepts are like functions. Blank is red. It's not a complete expression, redness. Only complete entities, which are objects, can be named. Therefore, three, when we refer to a concept or a universal, we are referring to a dummy object that stands in for it for purposes of reference. As Frege famously said, the concept horse is not a concept, to the great puzzlement of everybody. But he had a rationale for saying it. The two premises are his recognition of the same problem as Aristotle identified. But the solution is more ludicrous than Plato's own theory and leaves the ontological status of the concepts themselves utterly obscure. The answer is to be found in Aristotle's implicit position, for which all the materials are provided, but which Aristotle never articulates, which, as the ancients complained, is often the case with his more important metaphysical cruxes, say in the philosophy of mind. So Aristotle part two, which is Aristotle being drawn out, as the Neoplatonists would, you cannot have individualized forms, instances of universals, without forms, without universals. Therefore, there is or are some mind or minds which thinks all things for which there are forms or universals. For the individual, this is the active intellect. For the cosmos as a whole, it is the prime mover. This, that is, providing a solution to the problem of universals is a use to which Aristotle never explicitly puts either the active intellect or the prime mover. But as three, you cannot have individualized forms without forms, seems blatant. This development of the theory seems obvious, as are all the bits are provided. It gives one the Neoplatonic nous in a straightforward manner. And so it turns the Platonic world of objects into an objective mind. Not our mind, not an individual mind, but a mind, as it were, that can think everything. I hold what will seem to most people to be the bizarre view that Neoplatonism gives us the best philosophical logic, at least for this set of issues. There are two kinds of theory about abstract objects. According to one group, they are created as tools for understanding the world. Hartree's fictionalism about numbers, Hartree Fields' fictionalism about numbers, comes into this group. But so does conventionalism about logic, as found among most traditional empiricists. And in a more objective kind of way, because he's quantifying over them, in Quine's belief that some abstract objects are needed by science. The Platonic side insists on the objective reality of abstracta, independent of our thinking and constructing and understanding. But we've seen that this latter group involves an awkward treatment of concepts as objects, in Frege's phrase. Treating the Platonic world as a divine intellect combines the advantages of both groups, in that it combines Plato's objectivism with the idea that the Platonic realm is a mode of understanding. I also believe, as an aside, that this solves the problems in the Plato's Sophist that concern how to accommodate what are later called transcendentals, such as identity, which are objective but not actually properties of things, but are essential modes of understanding, without which there couldn't be a world, one might argue. Platonic objects are fictional or conventional in the sense that without the act of intellect and understanding, they would not exist. But unlike the secular version of these theories, this mode of understanding and intellect is presupposed by and precedes the natural world. Yeah, I think I'm going to be even shorter than my quarter of an hour that you'll have me then. A final footnote before my conclusion. There are two aspects of mind, the empirical and the intellectual. These two aspects have not usually been brought together in the history of philosophy. Empiricists have tended to be reductionists about the intellectual, to be nominalists and associationists, or more recently, behaviorists or functionalists. Whereas those who stress the role of intellect in resisting naturalism, the classical and scholastic traditions, seem to have treated perception, and therefore experience, in a very naturalistic way. Because of the role of quality, not quantity, in the Aristotelian or the ancient account of form of naturalism. On my view, they both reach beyond naturalism. What is more, they are not as distinct as sometimes represented, because recognition is an intellectual act and also an essential part of sensation. But I can't pursue that thought further here. Conclusion. I've sketched a defence of empiricism over scientific realism, and one that makes our conception of the natural world essentially dependent on the nature of human experience. I've also sketched out, even more sketchily, reasons for believing that the natural world presupposes a world of Platonic intelligence in which we in some way participate. I've said nothing about the arguments purporting to show that our world must depend upon some first cause external to it. That's a wholly different issue, though I'm very sympathetic to that line of argument, nor about the problematic nature of the concept of matter, which is essential to naturalism. There's a Berkeley, and I'm quite strong on that one as well. I have, in a sense, stuck much nearer to home. Whose home, I'm not quite sure. Quine defined naturalism as the recognition that it is within science itself and not in some prior philosophy that reality is to be identified and described. In a sense, I've not been disagreeing with this, but I've been claiming that our understanding of the natural world, and that understanding includes what Quine labels as science, presupposes other realms. We get to them, as it were, through thinking about our understanding of the world. Quine is right to say that there is no simple distinction between science and philosophy or metaphysics. But reflection on the natural world and our understanding of it leads us to things not dreamt of in what is normally conceived of as naturalism in philosophy. There you are. I hope I didn't presuppose too much on that, I'm not sure.
I think everyone agrees with both presuppositions.
All right.
Thank you. Yes, I think it is. Thank you very much for an excellent talk. And we've got some time for questions, of which I'm sure there are several. Professor Tree.
I should say, just before I hand the mic over, if you do allow the microphone to come to you before you ask your question, that will allow us to capture it for the cameras.
Right. You mentioned that standard physicalism can't capture any conception of the physical, you say, that goes beyond the purely abstract or mathematically expressed. But I don't understand how physicalism can capture the abstract in the first place or mathematics in the first place, because surely the physical world is precisely not abstract objects, not mathematics. So, unless you define physical in a very peculiar way.
I don't think we're disagreeing about that. I mean, If you look at, as it were, science without the interpretation or modelling that depends upon the experiential, all you get is the mathematics. Now, if you want to say that what you're therefore getting doesn't amount to any conception of the physical world, I mean, that is my point.
Yeah, but I think normal physicalists want to, in a sense, that they're a kind of modern version of materialism, and they're in a sense trying to do down the abstract and not really account for the success of mathematics either.
Right, I mean, that's the Platonic world, that in order to do what they end up with science doing, they're presupposing something which is more than the...
Well, that's really what I'm saying. I mean, I'm agreeing with you in the end, but I just think physicalists shouldn't be allowed to just claim the abstract and mathematics just without it being queried.
You see, it's a general truth about philosophers that if they're doing one bit of the subject, they ignore what they might think if they were doing another bit. A good case of this is the excellent book by Mark Sainsbury on reference without reference. In other words, how you can have reference without when you're not referring to anything, which goes against the standard doctrine in modern philosophy of language and logic. In the index of that, the term intentional object doesn't occur. Whereas clearly, the notion of an intentional object is something that you can refer to even if it doesn't exist. Because he was doing philosophy of language and logic, he wasn't doing proper latitude and philosophy of mind. So I think one thing that the standard physicalist does is somehow take for granted our ordinary notion of the physical, thinks the physical world isn't just a mathematical entity, though some do. Some go for a kind of Platonism about the nature of the physical world. Usually they wouldn't count as ordinary physicalists. But don't notice that they can only do that if they project into the world something which belongs to the realm which they don't want to allow, namely the qualitative nature of experience. So I agree with you, and I think that's one respect in which I think their position is in various ways incoherent.
Yeah. A question back there.
Thank you. Is this on? On?
Yes. It won't amplify your voices. Just
thank you. Professor, I'm rather nervous. I'm going to read this to you. I do welcome your explanation very much. I've been developing a naturalistic explanation of religions, that religions have been developed by different cultures simply to relieve people of depression. The purpose of religions in different cultures is mainly to relieve people of depression. There's very little reference to anything transcendental. If there were, then religions could agree, I guess. If your understanding of the natural world were generally accepted, especially by young people, then recruiting young people to kill themselves and kill others would become less attractive. Would you like to comment, please?
All right. Well, that's raising a very different set of issues from the ones that I've been talking about. I don't know your reasons for thinking that the explanation of religion is that it relieves depression. I'm sure all kinds of things can relieve depression, and religion can do all kinds of things. In some cases, it can relieve depression. In other cases, it can cause dark nights of the soul. So I don't know. I can't really engage with that suggestion. Now, the question of why, if I were right, all religions would agree. But in some moods, putting aside very primitive forms of religion, animism and all the rest of it, it's amazing the extent to which a Neoplatonic first philosophy lies behind most religions. A Buddhist friend of mine from my Liverpool days had been reading Plotinus and said, yes, this fits in exactly with his conception. That was an odd bit about the self and the one, but nevertheless. So there is you could do the same with Hinduism, you could do the same with the philosophical side of Judaism and Islam, in so much as they do have a philosophical side. They're much more legalistically based in some ways. So on a philosophical level, those religions that have developed a line of philosophy are not that different on that level from one another. So if you've got to look at Avicenna, Philo, Augustine, and the way certain people like to understand Hinduism, there is a commonality. As far as your, as it were, cognitive science of religion account of why people come naturally to believe it, you know, I don't know that I can say anything about that, because I don't know what your particular reasons are for understanding it in that way. It's very interesting. Some years ago, the standard, if you like, secular or atheistic account of how religion happened was that it's all social conditioning. Now it's gone much more to the idea we're built for it. It plays an essential role in our nature. And then the apologists for the atheistic position have to come along and say, ah, yes, but that's really just a sublimation of something more fundamental. You know, you see the trees moving and you think there must be a mind there, that kind of boy stuff. But I really can't, you know, I'm not either competent but I mean, the fact that we have a natural inclination to believe it could cut either way. as to whether it's true or not.
Well, thank you for a wonderful talk. I was a particle physicist for some years, and when I started studying philosophy of the priesthood, it took me quite a while to get over my physics. I do love physics, of course, but it did train my mind, the way it's done these days, to think in very narrow ways about reality. There's just, you know, there's just the quantitative, and if you can't measure it, it doesn't exist, as a professor would told me at this university when I was a student. I'm very interested with that background in any kind of good spell-breaking tactics. So you mentioned the Qualia experiment of Jackson, which is used a lot, of course. I liked your image of the four-dimensional and higher-dimensionality objects, because that shows that formal description isn't enough. It's not the experience of the four-dimensional is very hard. As a collector of these clever little thought experiments, do you have any other good recommendations for breaking the spell of naturalism? Thank you very much.
Well, I don't know whether this quite meets your requirement, but something that's become quite fashionable nowadays, as you probably know, is Russell's neutral monism, which gets turned into panpsychism by some people. Bertrand Russell in 1927, and he knew his physics, when talking about the nature of matter, said, look, all science tells us about is structure. It doesn't tell us anything about what it is that has that structure. Its relations, what are the relata, if you like. And he put that together with the problem of consciousness and said, oh, well, when you're conscious, is what you're seeing or experiencing is the intrinsic nature of the matter in your own brain. And that way, he gave intrinsic nature to matter, the qualitative nature of experience, and he gave ownership to, gave qualitative nature of matter and explained consciousness, as he thought. Of course, he wasn't very good at saying what the difference was between the qualities and being conscious of the qualities. He was trading in on a Humean ambiguity of the notion of impression, though he sometimes spoke behavioristically about what it is to be conscious of them. But so that's a line of thought which has got a lot of followers in the last 20 or 30 years. Grover Maxwell revived it, Michael Lockwood, poor Michael, and now Galen Strawson in the panpsychic development. So if you think that there is a problem about a purely structural view of the world and consciousness, that's been pressing people towards a kind of panpsychism. Which I wouldn't recommend the panpsychism, but nevertheless, it's an interesting. And also, Russell himself said that his ontology was kind of idealist, though his explanatory scheme was entirely scientific materialist, because he thought the laws of nature were the laws of physics, which is an interesting combination.
Thank you.
Ralph,
yes.
Actually, I had only. But I enjoyed the talk immensely. I had a petty technical issue I wanted to pick you up on. So I think it related to the first part. And what I wasn't utterly clear on was the relationship between the epistemic points and the metaphysical points. And in particular, you said at one point, I think, that it's a necessary condition for supervenience that if A supervenes on B, then we can conceive of B without A. Or if Fs supervene on Gs, we can conceive of Gs without Fs. Now, I was wondering in particular what our reasons are for holding this. So as the supervenience relationship is often defined, it's a relationship such that there will be no changes in Fs unless there are changes in Gs. Now that relationship trivially holds between everything and itself, and you can't conceive of anything without itself, so it seems like it's false that if A supervenes on B, we can conceive of B without A. So I just wondered, where do we get that from, and is it muddling epistemic and metaphysical matters?
It's assumed, I think, that A and B are not just the same thing, because supervenience discourse in the philosophy of mind was meant to replace identity discourse on the whole. So it wouldn't be... Supervenience is meant to be an asymmetric relation, so it wouldn't be right to apply it in the case of identity. Now, it, of course... Okay, perhaps I expressed that carelessly. If somebody believes that mental states supervene on brain states with metaphysical necessity, they're not going to hold you could have the brain states without the mental states. Right. But they should hold that the notion of what it is for something to be a brain state or a physical state is independent from the notion of what it is for something to be a mental state. So the very notion of the physical shouldn't depend upon the notion of the mental. And that's what I was claiming. And whereas if my argument's right, the very notion of the physical does depend on the notion of the mental. So I don't think I was breaking any rules.
That sounds watertight.
You're just being polite.
Using chair privileges, I might actually ask a question.
Thank you again for the great talk, which I also enjoyed and perhaps fully agree with. But just for argument's sake, you said that the scientific conception of the world is either purely mathematical or formal, or assumes a mathematical or formal base for such a complete description, a necessary base. This is something that doesn't include the rich qualitative experience. Now, I was wondering, connecting to an example from popular culture, whether we couldn't allow experience of the purely mathematical or formal. If you think the movie The Matrix, you see one of the programmers sitting in front of the screen looking at the code, and he says, it's code surely, but I only see blondes, brunettes, and redheads, and so on. So in this scene, the idea was that experience is something that the machines in that world toy with to obscure the fact what it is that actually underlies it. But we can get at it and both see it and realize what sort of images it might produce in that particular example. A more down-to-earth example would be, I don't know, if one's doing geometry in school, isn't there some sort of experience that attaches to knowing what it's like for there to be a triangle or something, or recognizing a triangular pattern? I don't know.
I'm not sure which of two things you're saying, or whether you're saying them both. One is that somebody who understands a code or a language can read it and then imagine what that piece of theory is meant to produce, so to speak. So you look at the computer code and you say, oh, yes. In the way that somebody can look at a piece of music, I mean, and say, know what it would sound like. I don't think that in any way contradicts anything that I'm saying. To contradict what I'm saying would have to be the case that somebody who'd been deaf from birth could look at the notes and know what it would sound like. And that doesn't make sense. One instance of the role of experience, the other thing you might be saying is what people now talk about cognitive phenomenology, that in addition to there being an experience of a sensory kind, there is actually the experience of understanding. And again, nothing I say goes against that. And the case often cited there is, you know, when I hear somebody speaking Hungarian in Budapest, I hear the sounds, but I don't know what it means, unless with the odd word. Somebody who knows Hungarian hears the same sounds and also experiences what it means. And that isn't just a behavioral thing, according to cognitive phenomenologists like Charles Siebert and David Pitt, and I agree with them. But I don't think either of those points harms my A nice instance of how experience is necessary to understand what's going on is a story. One of my old tutors in the 60s, Jim Urmson, when we were doing some cant, told the following story about Gilbert Ryle. As you might know, in the late 40s, there was a controversy going on in analysis about whether can't be red and green all over was an analytic truth or a synthetic truth. But it seemed to be necessary that a surface can't be red and green all over. And if it's not analytic, it would be a synthetic necessity. And they didn't like that kind of thing in the late 40s because it was a bit too Kantian for the positivist spirit. And so Gilbert Ryle went to Sir Rupert Cross, who'd been blind from the age of one, but who was a lawyer, a fellow of All Souls, and a very interested in philosophy, and said to him, "Rupert, what would you say if I told you that wall was red and green all over?" And Sir Rupert thought for a minute or two and said, "I think it would look very nice, Gilbert." Now, his putting Wittgensteinians down, his command of English was perfect. But without the experience, he didn't really grasp what was the, as it were, essential features of a surface being coloured. After all, you can hear sounds at the same time, both unconfusing them and hearing them both. I'm not much good at that. That's why I'm not very good at listening to symphonies and things of that. But people can do that. Why can't you do the same with colours? And unless you know the experience, you can't see any reason why not.
Thank you, Professor, for a wonderful talk. I would like to ask your thoughts about the so-called methodological naturalism, which is taken to be necessary for practical matters in science.
You're quite right that I haven't talked about that. And I mean, clearly, if you are investigating the nature of the physical world, you don't run to the answer, "Oh, God must have done that," whenever you come across something you don't know how to explain. If you use that answer at all in that context, it's a long way down the line. And it's probably for something very general, not the particular result that you got in your lab last week. It must be a miracle that this lead turned into gold or whatever it was that happened in your lab. So in that sense, methodological naturalism is an entirely respectable thing. Is that what the kind of thing you were thinking of? Are you thinking something more? See, you could make it more general than that, like the Clifford business. You ought always to proportion your beliefs to the evidence. It's never right to go beyond the strictly evidence in the narrow sense when you believe anything. That might be thought of as a certain kind of methodological empiricism, naturalism. And that raises very big and different questions about when it's right to trust, as it were, your intuition, a word I don't like because it covers a million different things, and when you should just, you know, not believe any more than you can actually stack up the points in its favour at any given time. If that's what you mean by methodological naturalism, in this context, I don't know what to say about it.
Question from
thank you for a very helpful talk. You said at one point that some form of Platonic universalism is true, some form of Platonic universalism. And then you spoke a bit about Aristotle and a bit about Frege. But in what you said about Aristotle and Frege, I didn't detect you to be defending any particular form of Platonic universalism. In particular, because I feel that universalism has been under threat for a long time in philosophy from the alternative accounts of reality. And so I'm wondering whether you would want to say anything in defence of a form of Platonic universalism that you might find congenial?
Mm. By Platonic universalism, I mean the belief in universals, as it were, forms, concepts and all that. I mean, there are two... Plato's own view seems to be that these are kinds of objects. The Neoplatonic view is that they are necessary modes of understanding and not ours, not our understanding, but something, as it were, the world emanates from nous. Without some arch intellect, there couldn't be things. And I'm much more sympathetic to that. They're both Platonistic in that they assume that a presupposition of there being particular things is that there is some kind of realization of kinds, universals, as some kind of concept or mode of thought or entity in its own right. So the two views are the Neoplatonic view and the object view. Now, Aristotle himself attacks the object view, but gives the raw materials for the Neoplatonic interpretation, because he clearly doesn't, I think, believe that there could be instances of properties if there wasn't an objective existence of the properties, but he locates that, as it were, in some form of intellect, either the active intellect or perhaps the prime mover. He doesn't say anything about, as far as I know, the relationship between those two. And of course, the Arab tradition of interpretation is that there's only one active intellect. The Thomistic one, which I think is better for most reasons, is that we each have our own, as it were, active intellect. But I didn't go into that, and it's jolly difficult. Unlike everything else.
Thank you for the opportunity of asking a second question. I loved your talk. One thing jarred very slightly towards the end, because you seemed to be almost doing down the scholastic or the scholastic Aristotelian tradition, and yet it seems to be your natural ally for a lot of what you want to say. Oh, maybe I misheard. Sorry, because it's maybe because of the Platonic emphasis, and naturally maybe assume that it was Aristotle was on the other side of things as necessarily less favourable, because he's so from what I know of the Aristotelian tradition, it's so grounded in experience, almost like the most natural ally you would choose. So why would you end up favouring a more Platonic position at the end as opposed to the Aristotelian one?
Well, I mean, how Platonic Aristotle was, and how Platonic St. Thomas is, or Augustine, are the kind of things that people can argue about forever. And I did suggest that Aristotle was at his most, not so much enigmatic, as silent about the way certain of his thoughts could develop. And this was true right from the start. I mean, there were people who interpreted Aristotle's philosophy of mind as more or less a form of materialism right from the start. Alexander of Aphrodisias, more or less. Other people who didn't. And you don't get much from him. And the same goes for in the Middle Ages. I'm no expert on medieval philosophy, but some of the nominalists would have thought they were being Aristotelian. Others didn't. So... I wasn't meaning to put down Aristotle at all, and I said that the active intellect or the agent intellect were rather like the Platonic nous, then no, I wasn't trying to do that. But Aristotle is something that everybody wants to make. I mean, he's fashionable again now, and there's hylomorphism stuff that's coming back, and I'm very sceptical about some of that.
It is the last of our series on naturalism. If you go to the Ian Ramsey Centre or Humane Philosophy Project websites, you'll be able to find out about many exciting events we have in the future. But for now, I ask you to thank our speaker, Howard Robinson, for his talk this evening.